So the question which we're going to try to answer today is, do we work happily ever after? But actually the title which you had for your presentation actually also fits to my presentation. Should we be afraid for angry men? And in my case, I would say, perhaps. What is my research about? We're going to look at the effect of what I've did in the past 4 years, is I've looked at the effect of unrealized retirement expectations on mental health, job effort, and training participation, and only for men. And I will come back to that later, why we did that. More specifically, we looked at a very particular change in the Dutch pension system. We looked at the so-called abolishment of the FPU-regeling. I think many people will know it here, at least the Dutch-speaking people. It changed in 2006, and it meant that there was a huge retrenchment of pension rights for persons who were born before the 1st of January 1950. For the persons born after 1949. So the persons who were born before the 1st of January 1950, they remain entitled to an old generous pension system, the so-called pre-pension system, the FPU-regeling. And the people who are born just 1 day or 2 days too late, they are in bad luck. So there is a very clear discontinuity, and in my research I made use of this very nice discontinuity. Why is it relevant to look at unrealized retirement expectations? Now, there are several reasons for this. One of the reasons is quite obvious, of course. We have an aging society, and this aging society is going to provide us with serious challenges. First of all, we should think about the stability of the pension system. It's well known today. Every day it's in the news. And secondly, what is also quite important is that the OECD forecasts, due to the aging of the society, that serious labor market shortages will arise on specific segments of the labor market. And this means that older people have to be replaced. And the question is, do we have the people for that, for them to get actually those positions filled? And not for every segment of the labor parties, of the labor market it will be that easy. So it is relevant to increase the productive labor force participation of all the cohorts. Not only the labor force participation, but we should also think about how can we keep those persons productive. Also employers, of course, should be interested in keeping those people. One of the basic things what most policymakers are immediately thinking of is, what should we do? What should we do to fight this aging labor force? One of the things, of course, is postponing retirement. And it is seen as a solution. But the effect on well-being, productivity indicators, is largely overlooked. And it's, you can see it quite well, for example, when you look at, reports of the Netherlands Bureau, Bureau for Policy Analysis. What you can see there is that they are calculating the benefits of postponing retirement, but the implicit assumption what they make is, yeah, people will go on as productively as they were before. And the question is this really the case? So the contribution of my research is that I first exploit a natural experiment that generated a drastic change to retirement system. And what is nice here is that we have the clear discontinuity of the 1st January 1950, and when you're born just 1 day or 2 days too late, you are in bad luck. But we can assume that persons who were born on the last day of 1949 are not in essence different than the persons in 1950 who were born on the first day of 1950. The big difference is that they are just treated differently by the pension system. And this is relevant because when we look at existing literature, we see that, for example, the literature on health and retirement, the normal finding is that retirement is bad for health. And the question is, what is the causality here? Is it that when you are in bad health, it will lead to early retirement, or is it the fact that retirement decreases your health? Another good example is, for example, training participation, human capital investments. When you invest in your human capital, of course, you want to reap the benefits of it. So it could be that you think, let's postpone retirement so I can increase the period in which I can reap the benefits of my investment. On the other hand, of course, when you are increasing your retirement dates, or when you are forced to increase your retirement dates, this may also lead to training investments. And here, of course, it's quite clear you are forced to retire later, or at least you get a retrenched pension right, and the question is, how are you going to react? A second thing is what we did in this analysis is that we had a very detailed analysis on behavioral responses of workers to the pension reform. It is not only relevant to ask the question, is productivity going down, but also under what kind of circumstances is it going down, and which respondents of which persons actually are reacting more stronger than other people. So the NETTO experiment, as already told you, we looked at the abolishment of the FPU-regeling, which happened in 2006. It was announced in 2005, and it had some serious consequences for pension wealth. Under the old system, when you were born before 1950, what happened is that a person with a full career could retire at the age of 62 and 3 months against a replacement rate of approximately 70% of their middle wage income. When you're born just one day later, so for those persons, it counts that they can still retire at against this 70% replacement rate. When you're born just one day later, from 2006, you only get annually 64% of your pension wealth if you want to retire at the age of 62 and 3 months. And that is a huge drop in pension wealth, and you should work an additional 13 months to obtain again the replacement rate of 70%. And this 70% is particularly relevant because it is actually a social norm. Many people in the Netherlands retired around this age when they reached actually this replacement rate. Before the pre-pension system, it was 80% or even 100% with the FUD schemes. So what did we do? We collected survey data and administrative data for male public sector workers who were born in 49 and 1950. So we focused on those who were born quite near the treatment threshold. So we know that not other policies are intervening with it, so we can make a very clear distinction between the two groups, and we can assume that those groups are indeed quite similar. We use panel data, and that means that we follow persons over the period. So we have more, for each person we have more information, we have information for each period, so every year they get a survey. The survey was sent to approximately 28,000 men in the period of 2007 and 2011, and we focused on men because women in this cohort, it's an older cohort, have on average disrupted careers and they are not eligible for the early retirement. And at least they fall, that can mix up the clear discontinuity which we have, because the women who are actually eligible are probably a very specific small group. The response rates were quite good. For example, in 2007, we got 8,500 people who filled in the questionnaire. And of course, it decreases over time a little bit because of panel attrition. But even in 2011, still 5,700 people have filled in the questionnaire. One of the first questions that we asked in our survey was, what do you expect to get? What kind of retirement benefit do you, how high do you think that your retirement benefit will be if you would retire at the age of 62? And this is the answer which people gave in 2007. And what we see on the left hand, from the figure, we see the average expected retirement benefit for the year 1949. And on the other hand, we see it for the persons who are born in 1950. And the red line marks the date of the 1st January 1950. Now, what we see here is a very clear discontinuity. So people are actually aware of the fact that they have retrenched pension rights. And also most interesting is that the replacement rate is quite close to what people actually are going to get. For the group who still fall under the old rules, they expect to get approximately 72%, while it should be 70%. For the persons who are born in 1950, we see that's approximately 67%. Then the question, what is happening with the productivity or with relevant productivity indicators? So the general finding, what we find in our papers, is that the treatment had a substantial negative effect on life satisfaction, job motivation, and mental health. And this figure shows the same figure. The dots actually give the average the average depression rate for each 2 months, because there are not that many depressed people, of course. But what we see is that Depression rates went up from approximately 3.5% to approximately 5.5%. And it means that depression rates went up with 40%. That's a considerable increase. And also, for example, when you look at life satisfaction, we find, for example, we also included, for example, as a control variable in our analysis, for example, wage. And we see that the effect of being in the wrong group, the effect is as large as, for example, having a wage which is approximately also 40% lower. We should be very careful about it because, of course, the wage in itself is an endogenous variable, but it shows at least that it is a very big effect. And the most interesting part is here is that we find actually that people do not care only about the fact that they are hit by the reform. They care about that they are hit by the form, but that their colleagues are not. What we find is that the effect depends to a large extent of how many colleagues in your firm, on the number of colleagues in your firm who are treated or are untreated. And social comparisons between the colleagues explain approximately 85% of the whole effect. So people compare themselves with each other. And that's, of course, a quite interesting finding. Also for an employer, you should think about, yes, how should we ease the burden of the persons of the one person in my organization who is actually hit by the reform. And next thing which we asked ourselves was, what about negative reciprocity? Negative reciprocity, we have measured this concept with a validated set of questions. For example, a question like, if I suffer a serious wrong, I will take revenge as soon as possible, no matter what the cost. So this concept measures, in principle retaliation behavior. And this is quite relevant because we look, of course, at a very specific group, namely at the persons who are working in the public sector. And it was the public sector which initiated the pension reform in the first place, so they can hold their own employer responsible for the drop in their own pension rights. Now, the results are quite clear. The retrenchment of pension rights triggers a decrease in job motivation and job effort among negatively reciprocal workers, and it does not triggers an effect on persons who are negatively reciprocal. And most interesting, the effect is even larger for workers who may arguably perceive the treatment as more unfair. And that counts for, first of all, the persons who work for the national government, so the persons who work actually at the departments in which the pension reform was initiated. And secondly, for those who were born very directly after the treatment threshold, so the persons who were born in the first 3 months of 1950. And this shows that probably feelings of unfairly being treated, that of course plays a large role of how people are going to react. So should we be afraid of angry men? Perhaps we should. The question then is, if this has a demotivational effect, is what are you going to do about it? Can you compensate this effect? And one of the things what you can do as an employer is invest in human capital investments. And it is a particular HR instrument at which we looked at, especially also because we would expect, based on human capital theory, that these human capital investments could also be quite interesting. Huh? The period in which persons are going to reap the benefits, or the employer is going to reap the benefits, is longer. So therefore, we would expect that training participation increases. And this is exactly what we find. We find we have asked retrospective questions, and what we find is that in 2006, 2005 actually, that there was no difference. So 1 year before the reform, there was no difference in the training participation between the two groups. And in 2007, we see that training participation for the 1950 group is actually higher, and the difference is approximately 7.2 percent points. Especially what we see is that there were extra investments in lower educated people, but we also see a drawback. We see that not every worker has been, not every firm or in every organization within the public sector can compensate this behavior, can compensate the demotivational effect. We find that there are no extra human capital investments in small organizations, and that includes organizations with less than 1,000 employees. And this shows that especially economies of scale are very important. So only large organizations can help. before I go to my research agenda and before I go to talk a little bit about what I'm going to do, let's conclude based on these past results. The first thing, what is relevant here, is that we should think about cost-benefit analysis. What we do show is that pension reforms may have substantial negative effects on life satisfaction, job motivation, mental health, and it means that you should include it in your cost-benefit analysis. So assuming that productivity is not going down, that everybody is going to work as happily as ever after, is simply probably not true. Secondly, this research has also important implications for the debate on pension reforms. We see that social comparisons matter, we see that feelings of being unfairly treated matters, and then we should ask the question, should we really introduce, when we're going to reform our pension system, should we introduce such very firm discontinuities? Take countries like, for example, in Belgium and in Germany, there we see that they use more gradual ways of introducing pension reforms. And the question is, what are the cost-benefit analysis of both types? And finally, with active aging, we should think about how can we motivate people, how can we make sure that also workers in small organizations will not be put into a disadvantaged position. Now, the research, of course, is not finished here. And I think actually the most interesting research has still to be done on these two specific cohorts. The first question, of course, what we should answer is, what is going to happen with those people? Those people are now at the moment 62 and 63. Next year they are 63 and 64. So the likelihood that they're going to retire in the next 2 years is quite large. So it's vital to keep continuing to analyzing these cohorts and analyzing when are those people actually retiring. This will show how effective this policy measure was. And moreover, we also ask all those years questions about retirement expectations. We see that there are a lot of swaps in the retirement expectations. And the question, of course, is when we look back 5 years ago, what people filled in and their actual retirement behavior, we can observe that. The question then is, what is actually causing that people are going to shift their retirement expectations? Which types of workers are doing that? So that is a very important research question which you're going to try to answer in the next 2 years. Moreover, together with ABP and Cordaris, and co-financed by the Ministry of Social Affairs and Stichting Instituut GAK, we have created a new, unique, representative data set. It consists of approximately 5,000 employees and 1,000 employers. It consists of matched employer-employee surveys, so we can link the answers of employers to the answers of employees. In that sense, it's quite unique. And it now also includes cohort 35 plus. It includes men and women, so there we get the women at last. And we also have the possibility not only to look at the public sector, but also to look at the private sector, namely to the construction sector. And there, for the next few years, we also want to tackle some very important questions which we couldn't answer with our past data set. And one of the things what we really want to know is, we have looked at training participation, but we also want to look more carefully at other HR instruments. And the big question is, which HR instruments may contribute to a longer and more productive labor force participation? And it is quite simple, we can look at the HR policies as employers have designed them, as, and we look at the employer surveys, we're going to relate that to the individual data of the employees. Moreover, the question is, what happens with age discrimination? It is well known that age discrimination in the Netherlands plays a big role. The Dutch employers are the least positive about all the employees, I think, in Europe. It was somewhere, I think, in a TNO report a couple of months ago. And the big question, of course, is what is the effect of this age discrimination on relevant outcome variables on the individual level for employees? Thirdly, we want to look at moral hazard. I won't go into much detail, but you can imagine that if you see that there is a loss in productivity, it could also be that that persons will deliberately harm their employer and actually seek revenge. And fourth, the data set gives us also a very interesting new opportunity since we ask persons who are 35 plus, and that is that we can look also at another natural experiment, and that is the postponement of the state old age pension. And as many people know, persons who are born later than 1954 will have to work 1 year, are eligible for the AOW benefit 1 year later, and probably for the 1960 cohort, given their life expectancy, it will raise with 2 years. And that is, of course, a quite interesting thing. And we have already looked at the data set. We just got the data set in December, and I can tell you immediately that we see that there are indeed big effects on the retirement expectations. So it provides us also with new avenues to explore what is happening in the retirement system. So thank you very much.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Some of us have to go to jail, I think, for aggression and disappointment and other things. Questions or remarks? Oh, was that clear? Yeah, over there.
I'm Blas Schoen, actually, from the FHML, so I have I don't know anything about pensions, but I was wondering, you looked at the group that was highest threatened, the 50 group, 1950 group, versus the group that is probably most relieved that they are just on the right side of the border. What would you think happens with people that are born in, for example, 48 versus people after 51?
Of course.
Would they do the same? Would they report the same?
No. It's quite clear that we are talking, let's put it like this. We looked at the 1949 and 1950 group for two specific reasons. First of all, to increase the intrinsic motivation of the experiment. We wanted to get rid of all kind of other potential policy measures which have differentially affected the two groups. And secondly, of course, there were also constraints in money, because we couldn't, of course, I would have liked to invite everybody to participate. But of course, yeah, ABP didn't want to do that. Of course, what happens here is that the further you are away from the treatment threshold, the less you feel threatened the less angry you will become. We already saw it in our own data set, especially the persons in the 3 months will react the strongest. So in that sense, the effect is also will be smaller. Moreover, the effect should also become smaller because persons who are, for example, born further away, for example, take 1960 or 1970, those persons have also a longer time period to do something about the retrenched pension rights. They can still optimize their behavior, for example, by saving more or thinking, yeah, I'm going to retire later anymore, but they have also more freedom in their reaction to it. While those persons who were born in 1950, yeah, they only had 5 years to save, and you can't bridge a gap of approximately 1 year of pension in 5 years. That's almost impossible for everybody. So, yes, you are right in that sense. And that's also why it's relevant that we have now a new data set in which we can actually tackle this issue. Yeah.
I was not born at all, so that's not a problem. Is this a typical Dutch situation or Dutch phenomenon?
No, not at all, because what you can see is that, take for example Greece or Italy at the moment, pensions have to go up there as well. What is typical, I would say, is the hard discontinuity which we introduced. For example, in Germany there have been changes, there will be changes in Belgium, and there they take more gradual steps. For example, they increase the retirement age, for example, with 3 months instead of immediately with a full year, and then they have more cohorts which are affected differently. So in that sense, it's typical, but it's well known that in whole Europe, but also worldwide, that pension reforms has to be done. Perhaps particular for the Netherlands, of course, is we have a more aging society than in other countries. So it is somewhat typical for the Netherlands, but on the other hand, of course, these results also will hold for other countries, I would say. Yeah.
Yes, over there.
One of the fundamentals of our pension system is the concept of solidarity. And you might wonder whether these happenings have their impact on the solid feelings of solidarity, of the willingness to participate in such a system. Do you also investigate that? Because it is particularly relevant now that there is so much turmoil around the whole pension system.
No, we didn't investigate that. I have to be very honest. One of the reasons probably also is because the solidarity is especially in the first pillar of the pension system. It's in the AOW benefits, the AOW. And it is in the second pillar, of course, especially for the young people, they save for themselves at the moment. And there you see that the solidarity is way less. And that is one of the reasons why we didn't do that. But it's actually a good thing to include in our next survey, which we're going to conduct in 2012. Yeah.
Last question. Just for the history, no? Yes, please.
My name is Liam Pudin. I'm from the School of Business and Economics. First of all, thank you very much for your presentation. My question is, you said in the future you're going to look at measuring the whether they, at what point they stop working. How will you determine that? Is it when they stop working for their employer in the last 4 years, or what determines that you've retired?
Oh, that's quite simple. When you get the benefits of ABP, we get the administrative data. So we're going to use the administrative data of the pension fund for that. Of course, it could be possible that you're going to work afterwards, the so-called ZZ payers in the Netherlands. However, I was just at a meeting with Stichting Instituut Gak. Rino Akan was over there, and he was actually telling that the number of ZZ payers is actually not that increasing, and it's not a very big group. So it's not also that important, especially for the civil servants. It's not the biggest issue. And actually, what we also see at the retirement benefit, we still, for example, we still have the multifendric. For most people, actually, it's also quite relevant to retire before the age of 65, so at the age of 64 and 11 months, because otherwise you would lose a huge pile of your pension wealth. So in that sense, a small group will continue working. For example, professors, that is actually the group which probably will be a little bit...
They have to.
Nah. I know some people who've stood here and gave their last...
Yeah, and next day they start working again.
Yeah, that's true. Against a zero-hour contract. So is that really work or is it hobby?
Oh, well, both, I think.
Yeah. But anyway, it's. I think most people actually going just regularly are going to retire. Also, of course, given the financial crisis which we have at the moment, I don't think that many companies will allow room actually for older people not to retire. Also, remember that you are allowed to retire now on your 70th, but your employer has to agree with it. And the question is, are they going to do that in the times of crisis? And I don't think so, actually. At least in many cases, I don't think so.
Thank you very much, indeed. Raymond Montuzin, ladies and gentlemen.